لبيك يا حسين لبيك يا حسين لبيك يا حسين لبيك يا حسين.
السلام عليكم. My name is Jaffer Abbas Mirza. I am a researcher here in London and I am one of the azadars of Imam Hussein. My understanding of Imam Hussein is very vivid. For me, he's a master who teaches me how one should live his or her life, who inspires me to think beyond myself, who teaches me to have a compassion for others, who also teaches me how to sacrifice oneself to the Almighty. He has given me, he teaches me in a time when there is no hope. He gives me hope. My connection with Imam Hussein, to be very honest, is very difficult to define and express. I was born with the name of Imam Hussein, Imam Ali. I don't remember any other names other than the names of Ahlul Bayt since my childhood. I can see, I can listen, I imagine those names in my conception of the world. So from the very beginning of my life, Imam Hussein in the house of Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has been an essential part of my upbringing. So there is a kind of a lived experience with this household. So Imam Hussein, I mean, there is no such comparison among the house of Holy Prophet, but there is one personality that stands out for me is Imam Hussein, because he gave that sacrifice, which I would say is exceptional, which is very unique. And that's my belief that Imam Hussein was chosen for this sacrifice, because the all-knowing Almighty Allah knows that this is Imam Hussein, this Hussein can bear that pain. This Hussein can sacrifice his household just for Islam and Allah. According to my belief, although physically he's not among us, but his teachings, his sacrifice, his memory is pretty much alive. And that makes him alive among us. We can sense, we can feel his pain. We feel that Karbala is still happening. When we think of Karbala, if you say a word Karbala to me, there will be 72 people in my mind. There will be Imam Hussein, his son, his daughter, his wives, his sister, his brother. Those are the people that come into mind when somebody says Karbala. I don't think any other thing other than Karbala, other than misery, other than brutality that Imam Hussein and his companions face on that day. Muharram practices or azadari are not just ritual for me. It is a way of living for me. It defines my identity. It defines my cultural belonging and religious belonging. Azadari is a sigh of oppressed, where we come all together, where we remember the miseries of Imam Hussein, where we can express our pain through the miseries of Imam Hussein. Azadari reminds us that nothing, no misery is bigger than the misery of Imam Hussein and his family. The concept of Ziyarat, for me, I believe that Imam Hussein, the household of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, is present everywhere. We can even recite, when we recite Ziyarat, there's something in our mind that Imam Hussein, it goes to Imam Hussein. When we say Salam to Imam Hussein, we believe that. So the concept of Ziyarat is not restricted to one place. You can do it everywhere. You can do it at your home by reciting Ziyarat Imam Hussein and other things. But to go physically, Karbala is altogether a different thing. It has a very unique kind of an experience, which only will be experienced by those who go there. As going to Karbala is like going to meet your master, going to a place where your master and his household gave a sacrifice. When you go to Karbala, you see that maqam, that place where Imam Hussein was beheaded. When you go Karbala, you see that place where Hazrat Abbas went to get the water. When you go to Karbala, you see all those places which have some meaning for us, which have meaning for the followers. When you go Karbala, although, as I said, you can do ziyarah anywhere, but when you go to Karbala and you look at the shrine, you sense that Imam Hussein is there. You die to touch his shrine. You die to touch the zari, because this is how a servant, this is how a follower, this is how a servant meant to, this is how a student meant to meet his master, to bow down, to cry, to weep, to remind, to recall, to say it loudly that I am here. I was unable to be there when you needed my help. Now I'm here. I cannot do anything. I can only weep. I can only cry. I can just share your pain. I can sense your pain, although it's very difficult, but still I can try. Going to Karbala, looking at those shrines, looking at those graves, it has a very different meaning. Then you have a different sense of ziyarah. You feel that, okay, there is something there. There is something here. There's something physically buried here. I've never been to Karbala until 2018. For me, it was a kind of opportunity for me to think there's nothing bigger than going to Karbala. I think this is the time now, as I believe that I have a call from Imam Hussein, I have a call from Hazrat Abbas to go there, to meet him. So I got the appointment. So going to Karbala is kind of a dream coming true. As a child, I always wish to go Karbala, but I couldn't go for various reasons. And when I got the opportunity to go there, I cannot express my feelings. It was something very different. When I finally decided that I have to go this year anyway. So one thing I would like to share here. I was working in a Shia-based company where, like my brothers, every other Shia, I can firmly say that want to go Karbala every year. So since it was a Shia company, everyone was planning to go Karbala. So when I applied for the holidays, and so I got not a very positive response because there were lots of applications. So I was told that there are very less chances of my application being accepted because I applied very late. Anyway, one day I was sitting in the office and I was listening a noha and was like something like chale aao, come to Karbala. And so I was really depressed. There was something in my mind that my application will not be accepted and I won't be able to make it to Karbala this year. So I was very down listening this noha which says come to Karbala, and there was a sense of disappointment. I don't know what was it, but all of a sudden, I received an email out of nowhere. I remember, it was somewhere in August, and I had to make my plans. I have to go to Karbala in October. So in the mid or late August, all of a sudden, from nowhere, I received an email which I was not expecting. And it came from the management that my application to Karbala just got accepted. This was something that was a sign for me that this is where I thought, okay, the God has a bigger plan for me. Imam Hussein has finally accepted or finally approved my presence in his city. So it was a completely different experience, and this whole excitement got more bigger when this incident happened, which was not expecting. So it added a more joy, I would say, in my journey before going to Karbala, that now things, big things are happening now with me. Things which I was not expecting now have happened. In terms of preparation to go Karbala, I was a bit confused because I've been living in London for the last 3-4 years and I've never been to Iraq. So there was a sense of confusion over how the weather would be. So I just picked up one jacket and I was expecting it will be hot there. And there's nothing coming in my mind what to bring and what not to bring. I was just curious to go there. So I didn't pick anything. I just picked, I think I remember two, three pairs of my clothes and just a single jacket. And then we left for Karbala. So I arrived in Najaf. So I first went to the shrine of Imam Ali alayhi salam. Then I left for Karbala through what we call Mishi, or we call Arba'in walk, very well known Arba'in walk. It's more like 100 kilometer walk. So it takes normally on average 2 to 3 days on average, but it takes more longer time. So I, with my wife, finished this 100 kilometer walk in 2.5 days. So I was very tired because it was so exhausting, but it has a very different separate experience of going and walking on that route. So after 2 or 3 days, when I was fully tired and we were around like 1 or 2 kilometers away from Karbala, I was losing my energy. But then I saw a board that is Karbala is just 1 kilometer away from now. So it gave me a new kind of energy. So although, to be very honest, my feet were hurt and I lost all the energy. So I was thinking at one place, I was thinking to get the bus. But then this excitement, then this joy to see this holy shrine gave me the hope and strength to go there. So when you go to Karbala through Arba'in walk, you manage to end up first seeing the holy shrine of Hazrat Abbas. So I was tired, exhausted. When I first entered in Karbala and I saw the shrine of Hazrat Abbas, I remember all those exhaustion, all those tiredness disappeared. And there was something in my body, I remember, that I really wanted to cry, but I couldn't. I don't know what's happening with me at that time. And the more that shrine keep closer, the sound, the chanting of Labbaik Ya Hussein, it was that kind of experience which I cannot explain. And that's very, very unique in a sense. For example, I have been planning to go Karbala for many years, since my childhood. And then when you reach there, when you see the shrine of Hazrat Abbas, you are clueless. And I think that's something that shrine that Hazrat Abbas, the Jalal of Hazrat Abbas holds, that it takes your thoughts, it takes your emotions sometimes, and you are clueless. Because that's the Jalal of Hazrat Abbas, that his shrine is there, you can see it, but you're helpless. You're sometimes emotionless. So instead of crying, I was, to be very honest, clueless. And I can see the beautiful shrine, the magnificent shrine, and I just keep walking towards it. So I kept walking towards the shrine of Hazrat Abbas, because since I've never been to Karbala, I was so eager to see the shrine of Imam Hussein. But I think that's how this whole city is constructed, is built, the root of this whole walk is constructed in a way that you first go to Hazrat Abbas, say salam, then you go to Imam Hussein. So finally, when I reached the shrine of Imam Hussein, I remember there was nothing, just tears coming from my eyes. Although I was with my family, but for a second, I had no clue who am I with. And I also saw the people were just like, they had the same feeling as well. They were all looking, because I was sitting outside the shrine and I had my bag with me so I couldn't go inside. I was standing outside the shrine of Imam Hussein, very first time in my life, looking at the Imam Hussein shrine. And I don't know what happened, just all those stories, all those miseries I have been listening to, that came into my mind. I was just looking at the tomb of Imam Hussein's shrine. I I wanted to relate. I wanted to sense that tragedy. Going there is not an easy thing. You can hear the voice, other people are crying. You just want to cry there. So when I was standing there outside, thinking of shrine, thinking of that tragedy, and I wanted to go inside, but I couldn't go. So I spent around 15, 20 minutes outside the shrine, just standing there silently. When I first entered in the shrine, it was a long, long queue, mashallah. So it took me around 20 minutes just to get inside the roza, inside the shrine. And there were hundreds of people who were dying to go inside. And I was thinking, will I be able to touch that shrine, that zari? I was crying. I had nothing in my mind other than the name of Imam Hussein. And that's sort of a, I would say, an exceptional thing. That when you see something and you forget all the worldly things. I think the story of Karbala, the story of Imam Hussein is unique because we, as his followers, believe that we are part of his family. There is someone in the shrine who belongs to my family, who is very close to me. So I was crying. I mean, people were crying as they were crying for their fathers, and their brothers, and for their sons. So this kind of an attachment, this kind of relation is very unique. Similarly, I was also emotionally touched. So when I saw that zari, it gave me the feeling that all my wishes, whatever I wanted to do, whatever I wanted to see, have fulfilled today. I have lived the purpose of my life, have seen the zari of Imam Hussein. When I touched it, it gave me a different feeling. It gave me a sense of fulfillment. I sense that now I can die easily, now I can die in peace, because that's the purpose I have achieved in my life. I have touched his zari. And when I came out, it was so difficult during the days of Arbaeen to reach and touch the zari of Imam Hussein. It's a very difficult task. But when I did it, and I can sense that I can see that not many people were able to, because there were so many people. And when I touched it, it gave me that feeling that I have achieved the purpose of my life. Going Karbala is a wonderful experience. And when you come back, you have so many things to tell. You have so many things to learn. You have so many experiences to share. So when I was walking towards Karbala, during that march, during that Arbaeen walk, 100-kilometer route, you see thousands of people, thousands of different personalities and thousands of different characters. When you go there, you look at the stalls, the food, the water stalls. And I remember when I was leaving Kufa, when I was leaving Najaf, I was told not to bring anything, and I was a bit worried. You need some water, you need something for the route, for whole journey. And I was told, don't care about it, don't think of it, just go there. So I did. And when I was walking, I had just my bag and some essential things with me. And throughout the route, everything was there. And one thing I would like to mention here, I mean, I've lived in Karachi and UK, and these two parts are different altogether. And when I went to Iraq, I did not go with any expectations. So when I went there, it is, to be very honest, it's destroyed, because it has been in a war in the last 30 years. So as an empathy, as you sense that people have been war in the last 30 years, you don't expect much from them, because they have been devastated, they have been looted. So when I went there, I saw all those stalls organized, built by the local people. And I saw some people who were really poor, but they were very rich. They were very rich in a sense that they were ready to give everything, whatever they had. So one story I would like to mention. So I saw a family who was very poor, and they were distributing tissue papers. And I asked them, I mean, why are you distributing tissue papers? Just say for yourself. Then the kid said that this is what we have been collecting throughout the years. This is what we have been saving throughout the years to serve the Zawar. And I was thinking that even that family that was so poor, but they were willing to give everything whatever they had. So this is how the compassion, how compassionate this walk is. When you go there, you don't need to worry about your food, water. People are, even if you are tired, people are there who will give you free massage, who will serve you. Like, I remember, I mean, sometimes you feel shy and you feel very touched, I would say, when people are begging you to take things from them. Literally, I mean, I don't know in any part of the world where people beg to come to our home, rest there, eat our food. So this is something I've witnessed there. So Karbala and Iraq in general are a very ancient city. And it's not just the home of Imam Hussein, Hazrat Abbas, but there are so many other locations and places where you can visit, where holy personalities, like prophets, who were there, who spent time in Karbala. So when you go to Kufa, there are places where prophets spent their time. So when you go to Kufa, there is a house which is apparently the house of Imam Ali's sister. And Imam Ali spent their time there as well when he was the ruler of Kufa. So there are other places where, for example, the sons of Muslim bin Aqil, there are places where the sons of Lady Zainab are there. So when you go Karbala, there's a perception that there's only one place, but there are lots of places equally sacred, equally important are there. And I would say, when you're planning to go Karbala, just plan other things as well and give more time to your journey, because there are lots of places which one should definitely cover. Bidding a farewell was a different thing, was a difficult thing, I would say. I spent around more than 13 days there. Spend more time in Karbala because I wanted to spend more time in Karbala. So when we were coming back, we deliberately decided to take our return flight from Najaf just to say our last salam to Imam Ali. It was so difficult. I mean, our bags were packed, but we were looking for a reason to delay. And although we left so much margin in our flights, but we were deliberately trying to get ourselves delayed. And when I went to Imam Hussein Shrine, the last day I spent there, there was a feeling that this time, the moment I'm living right now, it won't come again. What if I die next year? What if I'm unable to come next year? And when I say my last salam, when I say farewell to Imam Hussein, I was thinking, when will I come again? Karbala teaches you so many things. And when you go to Ziyarah, when you physically go to Karbala, it multiplies. So there's one thing I really felt in myself after coming back. It's a sense of being nothing, I would say. It's a sense of giving everything to people. It's a sense that whatever I have is more sort of a responsibility towards other human beings. And this is what I learned during my walk in Karbala. I saw people there, they were giving whatever they had. And this is the message I got from there. Whatever you have is more like a responsibility. The more wealth you have, the more responsibility you have towards other people who are less privileged. And this is something I realized, that when I give charity, there is something in my mind that it's not a charity anymore. This is something, the right of other. This is something Allah has given me, which I have to return to those people who deserve it, who somehow, because of this crude capitalist modern society has created inequalities. This doubles, this multiplies my responsibility. And this is what I learned in Karbala. Karbala, I mean, when you look at the stories of Karbala, when you look at the story of Imam Hussein, you're nothing. We are nothing. If I'm asked to express, to define my journey in one sentence, I would say, I have achieved the purpose of my life. And going to Karbala has eased my burden. And it's something I can die in peace now.
Labbaik ya Hussein.